From police officer to England rugby star and even acting as a stunt double. Well, a body double.
Yeah.
For Hagrid.
Let's call it stunt.
Shall we?
Yeah.
Martin Bayfield is a man of many talents.
But the broadcaster's admitted he faced many obstacles during his career and is now working with Santander, whose latest research shows that half of people feel trapped in their jobs because of the pandemic. Martin joins us now. Good morning, Martin.
Good morning. Finally, able to talk to you.
Yes, we got you.
And we're glad you're smiling, because, yeah. we hadn't quite established communications with you earlier. We were a bit concerned.
You've got a glimpse of how I look for most of the day, just utterly confused and bemused by life.
I've told people in the past, feeling... Martin, in real life, you're not the jovial, happy giant that everyone thinks you are. You're a miserable so-and-so.
I'm awful.
Well, you've got an extra reason to be cheerful, haven't you? Because something very significant happened to you during lockdown, which you can share with the world.
Yeah, I became a granddad, which was just wonderful. The most everything you hear people say times a million. There he is, little Tig, and he is wonderful. He's a grumpy little sod at the moment, but he's great.
Where does he get that from, Martin?
No idea.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's one of those things, isn't it? We're talking about people feeling like they're trapped in their jobs. Mm-hmm. There's this endless, relentless notion of lockdown and when we're eventually going to get out of it. And people are missing these milestones in their lives, you know, birthdays, huge birthdays, important birthdays, the birth of their first grandchild. And actually, the reality of that is, look, you know what? There are things you can do. I'm fascinated because, of course, I know you well, Martin, and we've been friends for a long time. But your journey from police officer to rugby player and then an injury as a rugby player into what you did next is a sort of a story of fable within the world of sport, isn't it?
Well, it's quite bizarre. And I mean, everyone finds their own path. And I guess sitting here trying to give people and pontificate on advice on what they should do would be wrong. There are things to look out for. And I guess what I found useful when I was transitioning from having given up my role as a police officer for 10 years to then play professional rugby with 18 months, oh my goodness me, within 18 months, having to retire because of a neck injury. It sounds weird, but to keep yourself mentally and physically match fit so that when an opportunity comes along, you can grab it, you can go for it. So I was very much in the right frame of mind when the opportunity to work on the Harry Potter films came along. But subsequently, there have been opportunities that have come my way, and I haven't been in the right mental or physical state to do that. And I've let them slip by. I mean, this is, crikey, we're looking at 21 years ago now, this. There you are, Ben. Look at you. Harry Potter, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And also very much listening to advice from valued friends and family. And taking that step that maybe you've been thinking about doing for some time and making it the right step, however you need to do it, you just make it the right step. But I think certainly in what is a world that none of us could have expected, people are stepping up now.
That second still of you on the set was you pre-makeup, I think, wasn't it, before they actually started filming? But one of the things, because as you say, I was lucky enough to go onto those sets, and there is a moment when you walk onto set, and that's that shot of you walking with Harry into Gringotts Bank for the first time. It's extraordinary how you could feel like you were in a bank, even though you knew you were on a film set. How bizarre was that for you, though? You've just gone from being an international rugby player for a full-time job to suddenly being on a movie set, and even getting into the frame of mind where that makes sense, because that's a bit of a dream anyway.
It is. It was totally unreal. And what was amazing about that scene in Gringotts, that was actually Australia House on the Strand, which they made up to look like Gringotts Bank, is in that giant pocket, jacket that I'm wearing, there was all this special gold or coins that they properly minted to look genuine. And people on the crew were putting the coins in my pockets so that at the end of the day, I would distribute these coins and they could take them home. So I was basically a 7'6" fence for the entire scene, just stealing props off the set. But it was the thing, Ben, Suzanne, it put a smile back on my face because I'd left rugby before I wanted to, and I was very angry about it, and I was very bitter and twisted about it. And it took me away from rugby for a while. It put a smile back on my face, and it allowed me to then return to rugby looking at it now as a fan rather than as a broken player. And I fell in love with the game as well. So it gave me a bit of breathing space. And it also gave me a 10-year adventure, which is one of the great highlights of my life.
And, of course, talking of adventures, we have to talk Six Nations, which is coming back round this weekend. Big game as the English take on the Welsh, of course. Always an important one in the Six Nations calendar for both those nations. What are your thoughts?
Well, England need to up their game. Quite clearly, they were blown off the field by an inspired Scotland team, and they were adequate at best against Italy. And they don't need me to tell them that; they know that. And players within that team need to step up, and the game needs to be a bit more joined up against a Welsh team, which is 2 wins from 2. And okay, people will say, "Well, you played against two teams." They were down to 14 men for big chunks of it. But they are rediscovering their bite. England are up for a real fight here. They're in real danger of being overturned by a Welsh team, which is getting stronger and stronger. And we're not seeing huge development from England. Eddie's saying that he's working to a master plan. We all know that the Six Nations is about winning a game. We're not interested in the master plan. We want to win against Wales. So England are really up against it.
What about the French? The French being decimated by COVID, of course, at the moment. It feels like this could be the best French opportunity to win the Six Nations for quite a long time. They've looked in scintillating form as well with such a young team. How devastating would that be? And what's the implication as well, Martin?
Well, this is the first time I think we can genuinely say, without people saying, look, that's just a cliche, which French team will turn up. We can actually say it this time. We have no idea what French team is going to turn up because we don't know who's available. I think it's absolutely the right decision to take to play this game, because otherwise the knock-on effect, certainly for Scotland, if they played it in a week's time, they wouldn't have access to their players. So there is a huge knock-on. They've got to be sure that those players are clear, because if they then play against Scotland and give Scottish players COVID, then we're in a real problem, and there's a knock-on, and we could end up with what we had last year, which is a delayed championship, and we don't need that. So France have proven in the Autumn Nations Cup they can send a weakened team, and they nearly beat England. So and that was pretty much their third 15. So whatever team they send is going to be a very strong team. It's going to be in France, of course. It'll be a tough side.
I just wish it was England's round against them. That would have been quite handy if you thought they might have been a bit weakened and we could have got the points. Martin, it's always great to catch up. Thank you for joining us. Congratulations on the birth of Tide. Do pass that best on to the family.
Can I just say one thing? Yes. We lost a really, really wonderful man, Gary Halpin, yesterday, the day before. He was only 55. He passed away. So all our thoughts are with his friends and his family and the Irish rugby union team, because he really was a marvellous man. 55 is just too young to go. So all our thoughts are with him.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, absolutely.
We echo those sentiments as well, Martin.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining us this morning.
It's been a year of grief for too many
endless
people, hasn't it?
It doesn't seem to stop. Yeah. We just need to sort of hold on to the horizon, which is coming.